fun. How'd you come up with that Twitter name? Who'd you hire to do that? It was all of about 2 seconds back in 2009 when I hopped on Twitter. And I thought, my name is Pam, I like marketing, and I'm a kind of a nut. So that's where it was born. I spent 15 years working in corporate America, started my agency late 2009, early 2010. And one of those things where kind of the planets just aligned and everything kind of came together. So we do a lot of work with, our heart is really for the small business and empowering humans within the business, as well as we've done some work with corporate enterprise brands. But right now we're actually winding down parts of our agency and really are going to be focusing 100% on just training and consulting, because we are seeing a ton of gaps in the industry right now where just small business cannot afford to even pay for services and the help that they need. So we feel that our time is going to be much better spent in education and just empowering them to understand this landscape where the only guarantee we have is change.
Awesome. Thank you. Emily?
So my bio is a little bit shorter, but my name is Emily Thomas. I go by Emmy Toms. I am currently a marketing analyst at Expedia.com, and I'm also a Nikon-sponsored photographer. I've been shooting for a year and a half now. So I do a lot of freelance marketing strategy as well as freelance photography.
Awesome. And I'm a millennial, so I gotta post this on social before I announce myself.
Yeah.
Sorry, bear with me. We're gonna try and get more retweets than Ellen. Okay, so on Twitter, hanging with my peeps at Social Marketing Week. And I'll probably put it on LinkedIn too. I want to make it sound a little better though. Keynote speaker for Marco Rubio. Okay. All right. So I am the head of social insights at Adobe. And what I do is put out a lot of market research that kind of shows Adobe as a thought leader. And I've used a lot of bits of social in my analyses where I've predicted movie profitability for a few years. And I did a lot of things for Huffington Post around sports and how college sponsorships are extremely expensive. And people always make fun of me because I've done a few reports on LeBron. So they always call me the LeBron analyst. Jody Marty is my handle on Twitter. And nothing fancy there. My email was joemarty@adobe.com, so I really liked it, and so I just made it my Twitter handle.
I like the creativity, not, but the consistency is good, right?
Mine's the same. Yeah.
So I want to start off with, we have a really energetic Miami crowd. We're excited. Everyone's dancing and getting lots of... Stomachs full of Cubanos, lots of pork and beans. So just lay back and relax, get some good information from us. And we're going to start off with a question about Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, Pinterest. There's so many different options. I was talking about with Emily earlier about social fatigue. What are kind of some of the ones you would start with first as a small business, or if you want to build your personal brand, to get the most bang for your buck in your time?
Going once? Okay, you want me to go? Okay, so for small business, number one, I would say for any business, you have to obviously know your audience. You need to know where your audience is hanging out. Your number one goal in social, I always say, is to figure out where your audience is hanging out and then understand how you can go have the most relevant conversation with them that you possibly humanly can. Okay? That is a relevant, contextual, relevant conversation. Now, given the question asked, Facebook is kind of a no-brainer. I don't think any small business today can ignore Facebook. From there, you need to be looking at Instagram, likely, at least having a presence. Twitter is a very much overlooked platform for many small business that can be very powerful, both in the B2B space as well as B2C. And then, you know, if you're targeting a millennial audience or a demographic that's hanging out on Snapchat, you probably need to take a look at Snapchat as well as LinkedIn, right? So if you're in a B2B market as a small business, or if you're trying to connect even with other businesses and business leaders, you cannot ignore LinkedIn, right? We get more qualified leads from LinkedIn than we do any other platform, and I spend the least amount of time there.
And I want to kind of jump in on that is, so I tell people all the time that even if you aren't running your own business at a bigger company, you're running your own business. It's your personal brand. And so LinkedIn is valuable for getting recruited. If you're in school, you need to have it beefed up, because as a hiring manager for a lot of positions at Adobe, I can tell you that our recruiters first send over LinkedIn profiles before we even talk to a candidate. And second, I always look at LinkedIn right before I have an interview. So LinkedIn is extremely valuable, and I like that point. And LinkedIn Pulse
Absolutely.
Is kind of their blogging platform. It's a great way to kind of get your voice out there. Another thing, when I interview people, I see if they've written content to know if they might be a good marketer and kind of understand their voice. Emily, you're really strong on Twitter and Instagram. What would you kind of like to talk about?
Yeah, I just wanted to kind of piggyback off of what Pam was saying. Definitely, I would push Instagram. I've seen a lot of really cool small businesses use influencer marketing, reaching out to photographers like myself to grow their brand. Some examples is a company called Tentree. They have over 1 million followers now, and they were able to grow their brand just by reaching out through influencers. And so, and another cool thing about Instagram is that it has now has Instagram stories. So it kind of allows you to share that content on Instagram as well as kind of show the behind the scenes, which allows people to connect with your brand too. So definitely Instagram.
Awesome. I really think video is engaging, kind of talking about Instagram stories. And, you know, as a teaser in this kind of briefing for this panel, we talked about the Dollar Shave Club kind of selling for $1 billion to Unilever, which is pretty impressive. I mean, having tried out the product, it's not that great of a product. It's really their marketing has been amazing. And obviously they came in with a lower cost item, but their marketing is really what pushed them over, and that was led by video. What do you think about video and kind of its emergence, Pam?
Yeah, I mean, video is on fire right now. And so if your brand is not, and I mean that in a positive way, if your brand and in your business, you're not thinking about video, you need to. And video is changing. It's no longer, I remember the days of corporate and scripting every single word. I mean, I can remember recording videos and we would have like 15 different potential names for a product. And I'd have to record all those 15. You probably still can relate to that.
We still do that.
But I can remember, you know, our executives having to re-record things when just one word was wrong. And now it's so real, which I think is amazing. But I also see with some of the brands we work with that rawness is what's also scaring them away because they're so used to being scripted. So if you can figure out how to just embrace it, it's kind of like you can't just put your toe in. You kind of at least got to go up to the waist and say, I may make a fool of myself the first couple videos, but I'll tell you, Facebook is going to reward you the first time you do it. Facebook is rewarding you for being brave with video, and that organic reach that they're giving you immediately is going to excite you enough. If you're any bit of a numbers geek and you're looking at those stats, you're going to say, all right, I'm not so bad. Let's go do this again. And it will reward you without having to pay so much for advertising for people to see your content.
Well, also, I just want to say, too, that one of the most searched things on Google or second highest search engine is YouTube. So it's a really cool place for small businesses to maybe do like how-to videos because those are very widely searched. And so it's a great way for small businesses to kind of use that creative space and really develop that personal relationship with their audience as well. So.
Yeah, and let's touch on something that Pam mentioned, organic reach. So for those of you who may not be familiar, if you're kind of first setting up a small business and you post something, currently about 1% of your audience is going to see what you actually post if you aren't paying for it. So social, you know, along with evolving to this new raw video platform, is really pay to play now. And so you need to try and find as many mediums as you can to get that content out there and get your voice out there. And video is definitely one of those good ways.
Yeah, and on Facebook in particular, because I know we have a lot of small business people here, with the Facebook video, you can record a video, do a live video, or upload a video. And then if you even take $5, $10, $20, and boost that post, is your entry into advertising on Facebook, you will be amazed at the views you'll get, right? You'll get anywhere from an extra 500 up to 10,000 views on one video. Okay, I guarantee you that's a lot more than you just posting a status update on your page saying, come check out my latest deal, right? And so you need to move, as Joe is kind of saying, into this new world. And with the pay-to-play model comes more requirements for creativity and connecting with your audience. The days of getting these things for free just by having a Facebook page are done, unfortunately.
Yeah, and we're spending some time on video, but I think it's good to see is I've had this conversation with Pam and Emily also, is video is kind of what social was in 2005. So if you look back at your Facebook feed to when you first set it up back in the mid-2000s, you're going to find that you probably reached out to friends that you hadn't seen for a decade or longer, for those who are, 30 or older. And now it's all about content and images and other things, and it's just interesting to see the evolution of social in general. So I just reached 10,000 followers. Claps.
Yeah.
I'm really excited about that. So that means by about 2035, I should reach both what Emily and Pam have on their Twitter following. So I'm just going to sit back and relax a little bit here and ask them, how do you grow your Twitter following or your Facebook following or Instagram following for social?
Oh gosh, so with Instagram specifically, my account started really growing when I really engaged with the community. I think that's the one the unique thing that Instagram has is that it actually, the community gets out and they meet other people who are big on Instagram. And I think that if you're not engaging with the community and meeting up with other influencers, then it's really hard to grow your platform. And just really engaging with your audience and finding content that people can actually respond to. For me, I use my captions a lot. And I'll tell stories on there about the photos that I take, and people wind up tagging other people into my photos. And so that definitely helped propel my Instagram account to grow a little bit quicker. I know that Pam has Twitter chats, and so I definitely did a lot of Twitter chats as well to grow my Twitter account. But I mean, I just use my personality online. I will say like silly things that will get shared a lot. And I think that having your own voice and having your own personality and finding creative ways to share things differently will help you propel your platforms to grow faster.
Absolutely. And I'll just talk a little bit about Twitter and just in your voice overall. And I remember when I first hopped on Twitter, it was late 2009 by the time I started to kind of find my footing with it. And I remember I finally had reached like 100 Twitter followers, whenever that was. And I tweeted on a Sunday about my faith. I had been at church. And that was back when people were still actually following the people they followed, right? Nowadays, we more follow lists and that type of thing. And I remember tweeting about my faith and looking at my husband sitting next to me on the couch and saying, I wonder how many followers I'm going to lose when I send this tweet. I lost 50% of them. I lost 50 of them. And I remember looking at him saying, there's going to be 50 more where those came from. Because if somebody doesn't like that I'm going to tweet about my church on Sunday and share a video, they're probably not going to want to do business with me, right? I'm not going to judge them for their faith. I welcome, you know, different opinions and all kinds of things in life and diversity. So I think you have to figure out who you are. And, you know, to Emily's point, build the brand of you, and good things will follow. Now, of course, that sounds easy. You also need to use tools, right? You need to optimize your bio on Twitter. I'm a hashtag junkie, okay? So don't be afraid of using some hashtags. Don't be afraid of putting the right keywords into your bio, because people will search for terms and then they will auto-follow those people. There's tools like Manage Flitter is my favorite tool. You can follow people with certain criteria, and then if you're lucky, you'll get a certain percentage of follow backs. But the key thing is just to produce great content, attend events like this, be part of the online conversation, like the whole, so the SMW Miami hashtag. Use that hashtag. Create lists of people that are that you're meeting, right? You'll be able to grow your following organically and kind of grassroots, starting with small communities of connected humans. That's how I built mine.
Also just using visuals on Twitter too. So like using photography or, you know, taking photos at events will always get shared more than if you're just sharing a quote or a link or something like that, and always making sure you're being very visual on Twitter as well.
Cool. I think also, you know, going back to that LinkedIn pulse or, you know, setting up a blog for yourself. So back in grad school in 2009, when I was at the University of Utah, go Utes, the real U, since we're in Miami, the U of the West. And I set up a blog because I was going into marketing and I kind of wanted to show how I could produce copy or content. You know, I wanted to be like Don Draper. And I wrote about the NBA basketball negotiations and how they were going wrong because they were in a lockout and the whole season was going to be locked out. And I said, I did like 10 blog posts, 10 steps on how they could get this thing done. And maybe like 3 people saw it, right? But I was slowly producing content that you can now set up, auto send out on Twitter, or kind of put it in a system that it'll hit Twitter every so often for a few weeks and then spread it out over a month or so. And then you start getting regular content mixed in with your personal brand and voice. And I think that's really valuable.
Because if you learn to tell stories, right, and we're going to talk about that, since that's what this panel's about, right? But if you tell stories on one platform, it can grow your following on another, right? So the key thing that has grown my Twitter following has been the content I produce everywhere else, okay? Yes, I produce content on Twitter. Yes, I like to have catty, you know, the banter back and forth in 140 characters. I love that. But it really is about content and content distribution. Other people sharing content that's relevant to them, that's grown my following more than anything I've done with any tools or follow back. There's no magic tricks. It's about content at the core.
Well also, too, I started growing my Twitter account about 5 years ago, and I have about 130,000 followers on Twitter. And I just started my Instagram account about a year and a half ago, and I have 100,000 followers there. And it's because my Twitter account was so strong that I was able to go into Instagram and reach out to influencers and other photographers on Instagram. So back to what Pam was saying, it allows you to grow your other platforms when you have one platform that's really strong. So
yeah, there's a lot of cross-promotion opportunity that's really interesting. So I think you can almost, you know, choose that one that you'll find that you're probably apt to use one more than the other. I'm most strong. I really don't do much on Instagram. I'm most on Twitter because I'm mostly content rather than images. But you kind of find one that you fit really well with. And everyone that's looking at their phones right now, I assume you're all playing with Pokemon Go, because there's probably a big crowd of Pokemon in this building. I know Pam's a big nut.
Ask my son who's out there. He said there were a bunch of Pokestops around the hotel.
Yeah, so you know, if you need to excuse yourself, that's fine. But Pokemon's interesting in that it's kind of a current event that you could jump on and have a voice on. You know, you don't need to be 10 years as a marketer to have a voice on Pokemon Go or the ALS challenge of 2 years ago or some other current event that you can have a voice on, and people will kind of latch on to that, and you create a brand off of this one event, which is really interesting. So how can you produce engaging content for thought leadership, kind of building off of Pokemon Go? We talked about video a little bit, YouTube, other things. What's kind of your content strategy at, we'll start with you, Pam, at Marketing Nuts, and then you, Emily, for your brand?
Yeah, so we do a lot in the B2B space, so business to business. And so for us, we really look at the problems our audience solves. I mean, it's marketing 101. The problems our audience has, how are we going to help solve those problems? And to be honest, the past, like ever since I started, if you know, our business and our platform, 5-6 years ago, a lot of peers in my industry give me a hard time about a lot of our posts, like the top 5, the top 10. They're like, you're talking in such a 101 level. Like, why don't you talk about all this digital transformation? I'm like, because my target customer doesn't know what the heck you're saying with those buzzwords. You know, the leads we're getting that come in all day from LinkedIn, which you think is old school, are asking me, how can they get their brand on Facebook? How can I put a content strategy together? How do I get more followers on Twitter? Like, where do I start on Instagram? So you have to be able to, I think the first thing in building out your content strategy and engaging content is to know your audience and to be able to put on some blinders that turn off the FUD in your industry and in your niche, and listen to your customer more than you listen to where other people are telling you you need to be, right? I have a lot of peers saying, why aren't you on Periscope? Because my target audience does not even have the app hardly installed and is not watching it. Why am I not spending all day on Snapchat? Because they don't even know how to read my snaps. So that doesn't mean you don't need to be there. If you have a fashion blog or you're in travel or your audience is there, right? So you have got to, the first step in creating engaging content is connect so deeply with your audience and then find a way that you can talk in a human voice that's just so real that it just exudes from you and you get it out there and they're gonna eat it up.
I always like to use the example of the company Dove. When we think of Dove, we don't think of a bar of soap. We think of women empowerment and body positive messages and stuff like that. But Dove was able to connect people through that story. And even just all of us sitting up here, the reason why you guys are here to hear how we do things. So answering people's questions, when I post a photo on Instagram, they don't really care like how I got up there, how I hiked 10 miles to get to the top of some mountain. They care what camera gear I used, what editing tools I used. And so finding a way to answer your audience's questions so that you're actually helping them create their own content will help you grow your own content as well. So,
I'll be honest, as the dad of two little boys, I did shed a tear for that Dove Super Bowl commercial. So confession Thursday up here on the couch.
Aww. Everybody, aww.
So I helped co-found a team called At Adobe Insights. At Adobe, you should all check it out and follow it on Twitter. And our content strategy is just more around analyzing data and putting out thought leadership that's really interesting. But our target, you know, is really more marketers and practitioners. We do like some consumer press. Like I said, I analyzed the movies and things like that. But we really focus on our audience. And I think that makes a lot of sense what Emily and Pam said, is we're really targeted at who we're trying to get. We know where they're going to be, and we want to have press where that's at. Pam, you mentioned Managed Flitter. What are some other tools that you're using for content creation, Twitter management, social management, and other things? And then you,
yeah,
Emily.
So for Buffer app is one of my favorite tools. And I think it's really easy to use. And they have, I don't know if they have a, do you know Kathy Hackle? I'm pointing you. Do they have a free offering? I always forget. A $10 offering, I think, for Buffer app.
They,
I think it's like
offering.
It's free. Yeah. And basically with Buffer app, you can load almost all of your social profiles in there, and then you can schedule content. So I don't know about you, but I have little time that I actually can, I can't be reading content to find to curate during the day all day, right? But yet I want it to trickle out. So I primarily use Buffer app for when I'm in the morning and I'm reading the news and I'm, you know, finding good content that to share, and then I schedule that. So, and then I'll take some of our own content and I'll schedule it out a week at a time. And you can just auto-schedule it, or you can choose what day it goes out. And then it will give you some great metrics as well. We use Sprout Social. I'm a big fan of Sprout Social. It's affordable for small business. Simply Measured is a good platform as well. But I, you know, I believe in just keeping it simple. I actually live on the Twitter native app a lot when I'm on my phone. I think it's the best way to engage. And even on the desktop, TweetDeck is another favorite, Hootsuite. But, you know, I also live in Google Analytics, you know, and I think Google Analytics is one of the most overlooked tools when it comes to content success. And if you have a blog and knowing what content are people reading, responding to, the traffic that's coming to you from the social channels, be that Twitter, be that LinkedIn, Instagram, what content are you getting from what channels, and what's that engagement, and how long are they staying on your site? Are they bouncing out of your site immediately, all the traffic coming from one platform? You need to know those details, and it's going to help you so much in creating better content.
Buffer does have a free app. We have confirmation from Kathy Hackle. She knows everything back there.
And I want you to know, I'm not paid anything by any of these tools. So like Buffer app, they're a great brand example for this, right? They deliver great service. They provide great content. It makes me feel good to be able to tell other people to use their product.
Yeah, and the key to me, then we'll go over to Emily, is analytics. And, you know, you also don't have to have money for analytics. I'm going back to grad school, I set up that blog, and I set up Google Analytics at the time because I couldn't afford Adobe Analytics, which is way better, but and it's free, and so you set it up on your blog, you can see where people are coming from, and you can kind of know where to target your paid media. And I spent like $10 a month on my blog when I was in grad school, just so I could kind of learn those elements. And so you don't necessarily have to have a big budget to learn how to use analytics.
So one of the things that I actually do at Expedia is I measure the success of our marketing campaigns there. And there are a lot of people, really creative people, creating really awesome content, but they're not necessarily growing their platforms, which is such a shame because they have such cool work out there. But I also think that like measuring your analytics, it helps you save money in the long run when you're investing into maybe it's Facebook ads or something like that, because you're able to see what people are actually responding to and what they're not. And so you know more of what to produce more of and what things you should be producing less of. So.
And one more thing too is just the insights that are available while we're out talking data in the native platform. Like, so on Facebook, you know, how many of you know on Facebook the optimal time that you should be posting for your fans? Raise your hand if you know that. Okay. All of you should know that. You want to know why? Because it's there for you to learn. The data exists in your Facebook insights that you don't have to pay for. Same thing with Twitter analytics. I mean, you can see when who your audience is and when they are online to respond to your content.
Yeah, that's a really good point. One other really cool free tool, add to it, not a plug, not tied to this product team at all. It's Adobe Spark, and it's completely free. And I was telling Pam that I actually used it to intro a presentation I did the other day. And it basically helps you cut out a graphic designer. So you're going to be able to, lots of really cool, Instagram made filters famous, and Adobe Spark is making design filters famous. So it helps you do really quick designs. Adobe Spark is the name of it, yeah. So check that out for video, image, and audio. It's also really good for if you have little kids doing show and tell projects.
For sure, and we even do a lot of work with franchise organizations, and we are getting ready to really educate them more on Adobe Spark to empower them. Because even if you are working with an agency, you can't always afford to have an agency do everything for you, particularly small business, right? So I think Adobe Spark, if you haven't looked at it, it is a great tool. You can, in a few minutes, put together an engaging video that Facebook's going to reward you for.
So one last question, and then we'll get into some Q&A. So this is obviously a great event. Everyone's real excited. You know, there's lots of conversations happening on SMW Miami hashtag on Twitter. How can we kind of expand that excitement and content we've learned from Social Media Week to more than just today, tomorrow, Friday? How can we expand that content to over the next month, 2 months, 6 months?
Okay. I don't always like to be a mic hog, so I try to like. All right, so I would say, here's my number one advice to keep the party going after the party, right? Is don't share all your good stuff right now, okay? Live tweet, do that, but keep like a running list of things. Like I love, I heard Peter Shankman speak a couple weeks ago at an event, and I loved how he said, you know, get out your laptop or whatever, your note app on your iPhone, and start taking notes. Like you don't have to tweet at that moment every single thing. Make sure you're live tweeting and you're supporting the event and the hashtag, but take some of those nuggets and then maybe turn it into a blog post, right? Let them like curate with you, settle with you a little, percolate, that's the word I was looking for, percolate with you a little bit, and then share it out over time, right? And don't take the Facebook, don't take your images and post them to Facebook at 1 o'clock in the morning because that's when you get back to your room, okay? Unless Facebook is telling you that's when your audience is online, right? So if you're posting them on the business page, wait until an optimal time and then put some time into it. Make an Adobe Spark video. Go take a quick, some of your images and make a quick little video, right? Make it a step up. Take that content and take it a step up and then filter it out to your channels over the next month. You can make content from one day of an event, spread that out over 30 days or longer. Turn that into an end of year video where you share all of the events that you went to. You make sure you take some great selfies with your friends and, you know, influencers in your industry and then have an end of year video and say thank you to my community. Right, tell stories and keep that going.
Well, also too, I'm a travel photographer, but I have a full-time job. So I like to portray this image that I'm traveling all the time. So actually people do think I'm traveling all the time, but I'm not. I will go on a trip and be on a 5-day trip and I will stretch those photos out for about 3 months and then I don't have to travel for 3 months. And then people are like, how are you always in the Canadian Rockies? Or how are you always in Thailand? I'm like, I'm not always in Thailand.
I'm in bed.
Yeah. I'm in Thailand for a week. And then you guys think I'm there for 3 months. But really, it does help if you're not just, and I get so excited about content that I want to do what Pam is talking about. And I want to share all of it right away. But sometimes it's good to share some of your really good content for later so that people can kind of look back on it.
And no promises, but if you take a picture right now of Pam and Emily and then tag them on Twitter and then 2 weeks from now include that Spark image that you created with a nice quote from Pam or Emily, they may retweet you and help your following.
Yeah, and that's a good point, right, is to include other people, right? It's about the OPC. Who knows the song OPP? You know me. But it's about... When we do workshops, we make people sing and dance to that song. So you're lucky I'm not making you do that. But it's about other people's content and other people's community, right? And we are all so much more powerful together than we are as one, right? Us sharing each other's images and helping amplify this event overall and the fun we've had and what we've learned and the content. You know, make your content for this event be 80% just sharing other people's content. And guess what's going to happen? Then you can focus on quality content that you are sharing from those notes you're taking. And then everybody else, if everybody else is doing 80% curated content, your content's going to be shared. I know that was too many numbers for you, sorry.
Thanks for the time, ladies. At Pam Marketing Nut, at Emmy Toms, at Jody Marty. Any questions?
Yes, hi. I have a question. Do you recommend any amount of information that you can download for each day? How much is too much or?
That's a good question. I think there is something as far as like Instagram overload. I think Twitter is significantly more, you can put out a lot more content on Twitter. I know Guy Kawasaki, he actually has in his profile, it says, I will tweet multiple pieces of content 3 or 4 times a day to reach different audiences. So I think it just depends on the network, but you certainly want to be mindful of not overposting on like Instagram or something like that.
I know that when I first started my Instagram account and I was trying to grow, I was trying to be very active on that platform. So I was posting twice a day. I would post once in the morning and then once in the evening. But now that my platform is a lot bigger, I will only post maybe a couple times a week now on Instagram. I try to post once a day, but it's just hard to have that much content to post. But yeah, with a platform like Instagram, you definitely don't want to be posting as much as you are on Twitter.
Okay, and do you recommend that we use the same information in case that we have Instagram, Facebook, the same information for both, or it has to be different?
I think Twitter is probably the main differential one there. Twitter, you can get away with posting almost as much as you want. Facebook and Instagram is probably the most sensitive because it doesn't have the algorithms to limit posting like Facebook does. So I'd probably go Twitter the most, Facebook second, Instagram probably the least amount of posting.
And there's a cool app called If This Then That. Uh-huh, it's IFTTT whatever. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you the one feature I love about that app. I only use it for one thing. I connect my Instagram to my Twitter, okay? And the problem with Instagram is that when you post to Instagram and you tweet it, it doesn't tweet an image, right? It tweets a link to Instagram. IFTTT will tie it so you can automatically tweet a native image on Twitter every time you do an Instagram. Or you can say when I do a certain hashtag. So you can say, if I add this certain hashtag, then it will tweet. So then it shows up as a native image in the Twitter feed on Twitter, but it's also went to your Instagram. And if you wanted it to go to Facebook, it could have went to Facebook, could have went to Tumblr, or wherever you have it tied.
Okay, last question. How many hashtags do you recommend?
For which platform?
Instagram.
I'm a hashtag junkie, so I'm probably not a good person to answer that.
Yeah, Emily's kind of the opposite of that. So I think you're going to get two varying opinions.
I need the 5-step hashtag recovery program, please.
I actually don't use hashtags at all on Instagram, which is like, people get mad at me when I say that. But I'm not a big hashtag person unless I'm going to an event or unless I'm traveling. Then sometimes I will create my own hashtag. So say that I'm on if it's social media week, I will put all of my posts within that same hashtag so that if people want to know about that event or about anything that I did, I can say all of my content is under this hashtag on all of my platforms. So it really allows you to create a space where all of your content is available.
If you did want to go the hashtag route, probably the best way is to space it between your original post or post it in the first comment.
Yeah, correct? So don't post it in your caption on Instagram, but post it in the first comment beneath your caption.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And there's a tool called Hashtagify that's a really good tool that you can research top hashtags as well on multiple platforms.
Hello. Thank you guys for a great panel. Do you guys have any tips for monetization of blogs?
Can you repeat that?
Any tips for monetization of blogs?
So I actually don't try and do that at all. So I don't have too much to offer here. I know that you can, if you do create a pretty good YouTube video, they automatically set up advertising money for you.
Sure.
Once you set up your account,
what I would recommend is building out a platform. We have done that, and we now have a podcast, right? So we have the podcast, we have the blog. We don't, even when we launched our podcast, people said, well, you can never sell that for more than $500 an episode. We sell it for a minimum of $5,000 a month, okay? But that's a sponsorship for our platform. So they get access to a Twitter chat once a quarter, they get access to an event, they get access to email marketing. So I think the thing that happens so much with bloggers is we call ourselves bloggers, right? And that's, I spoke at a blogging conference recently and I said, you are not a blogger, right? It's like you need to run a business. And to run a business, if you want your blog to be part of that business, integrate it in other ways that you can monetize. And I think that's the biggest mistake that people that, because a lot of times bloggers just have a passion. That's why most of the good bloggers just started to share content, right?
Yeah.
And they may not be the best business people. So do some research and start to build out that platform. Get your following on other platforms, whether that be Instagram or Twitter or wherever you may be, and then figure out how you can put together a media package for people to have access to your audience, not necessarily just a post on your blog. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's just
because I think you'll find that if you're just looking for like Google AdSense or like display banners, like those have a very low engagement rate with them. So you really need to try and shoot for that more sponsorship opportunity that's going to get you actual.
I'm actually a Google partner, and my partner and I created a platform for bloggers that we basically use our knowledge of Google AdWords and AdSense to monetize. So if you guys do want to make some money for your original content, we'd be glad to have you on the platform. It's MCXV.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Excellent. We'll take a look. Thank you. Any other questions?
Hi. I'm not sure if this would be a good question, but I have two. The first one would be, what is your opinion on companies who put the same exact content on all of their platforms? So like, let's say they're posting it to Instagram and it's automatically going over to Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, everything like that.
I mean, I personally don't like that. Just because a lot of times if you have a really, I know with Expedia, with a lot of our dedicated audience, that they follow us on all of our platforms. So if they see that we're pushing out the same content on Instagram as well as Facebook and Twitter, then they kind of might get a little burnt out on our other platforms. But the cool thing about sharing content is that you can still share the same content on your other platforms if you do it in a different way. So something that I like to do is if I write a blog post or if I do an article or something like that, I'll share the photo on Instagram and maybe put a link to it in my bio so that people can click back to it. And then on Twitter, instead of just sharing the Instagram post onto Twitter, I'll pull a quote out of the article and share it on Twitter. So that way I'm still sharing the same article, but I'm not sharing it directly from Instagram. And so I think you can still share the same content across platforms if you find different ways to share it.
And do not, I'm a huge believer in Facebook and Twitter, do not combine them, right? It is a completely different audience. I think there's a little bit more crossover with Facebook and Instagram depending on what you're doing. Like for some of the things that she's doing, not so much, right? Because she's very, very strong on Instagram. And so there's a different tone that she has there. And there's a lot of expectations probably for your content there, right? So I think it depends on you personally. Like for me personally and for our business, Instagram and Facebook work well together. But taking a Facebook message and how some people will just auto-tweet every message, most of the people on Twitter hate that. Like, I don't want to have to go to Facebook and log in, and it causes all kinds of weird things on mobile, like if I'm trying to see it. Just, you know, you're better off taking that same link and linking to it natively inside of Twitter and making it a 140-character tweet that makes sense for Twitter, not a long one on a longer one on Facebook.
But that also lets you stretch your content out, back to what we were talking about earlier, so that you can share it for longer periods of time. So.
Okay, well, thank you for the questions. Oh, one more. Last one, you said you had one more, right?
Yeah.
Sorry.
My second question was, for businesses that deal with something serious, like, for example, financial or medical, how do you make that engaging for people on social media? Like, how do you show personality, for example, through that?
That's a really good question. You brought up two industries that I think are really struggling still, actually, with social. And I don't know that there's necessarily a direct answer for that. If I was the marketing manager for a financial or a health industry, I would probably try and make it as human as possible. Whether that's showing a family applying for a mortgage or showing an image that was like a college fund for a kid, or health industry would be maybe more like a doctor's visit or something that is probably maybe looks a little staged, obviously, because you're kind of on a more sensitive privacy barrier. But I would make it as human as possible, since they are kind of untouchable type businesses.
And I would say helpful. We've done quite a bit of work in the health space. Laser Spine Institute is one of our clients. And I would say helpful content, right? So go back to your needs of your audience. And you think of financial, this is what always drives me crazy when I see the financial brands, because so many of them are targeting young families, they're targeting, you know, a demographic that's actually really easy to serve content to if you think about it. Okay, what problems do they have? How do they need to save money? What do they need to do? And I know there's all types of guidelines and HIPAA regulations that we need to satisfy, but what are the problems they have, right? And in healthcare, how can you prevent certain ailments? How can you, you know, it's just getting human, like you were saying, and getting helpful. I think the helpful and the human combined can go a long way in a dry market that's so controlled with what you can and can't say.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.